joining us. We will be starting our program shortly. Thank you. Greetings, everyone. I want to welcome you to our event today. My name is Tracy Brown, and I am the curator of the Same Game Different Smokers exhibition, as well as the project manager for the African American Tobacco Control Leadership Council. So on behalf of our leadership at the AATCLC, I want to welcome you to our event, The Culture of Manipulation, today. I want to share that I am absolutely overjoyed that we have had such a wonderful turnout for such an important event. This is a hot button issue, so we have folks who are attending from all over the world. So we want to be sure to just let you know how important you are in the fight to keep all people healthy and nicotine free. And we appreciate your presence here today. We want to welcome our members of the African American Tobacco Control Leadership Council, our beloved partners in this work, as well as our fellow organization, Amplify. As in addition to the Amplify community partners, we also want to welcome our friends from The Loop, led by our very own beloved Dr. Valerie Yerger. We also welcome our friends from the Center for Black Health and Equity, who are always fighting the good fight, and they are the originators of No Menthol Sundays, which is an event you'll hear a little more about later. We also want to thank our community partners like the Dynamic Women of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, as well as our work partners, the Action on Smoking and Health, the Public Health Law Center, the American Cancer Society, as well as the American Heart Association and the American Lung Association. We want to thank our other partners like Stanford Health, as well as the representatives who are here from PAVE and the Campaign for Tobacco-Free Kids. We want to thank our public officials who are leading our communities, leading our cities and our counties and our states and our countries in making healthy decisions for our most vulnerable populations. We welcome the members of the representatives from the Hawaii Attorney General's office. We also welcome our friends from the San Jose City Council. We welcome folks from the city of San Diego, as well as the city and county of Los Angeles and the city's city attorney's office. You are more than welcome. And the governmental officials from around the country and around the world who are here today. We also want to welcome folks from the educational institutions who are doing the important work of helping us to continue educating people about this important issue. We want to welcome our friends from the public health departments all over the state and all over the country who have registered today, as well as the members of the press who have come out to help us spread the word about this important issue. I want to give a special, extra special shout out to my fellow artivists who are here today, as well as the teachers who are so concerned about their students. They're figuring out what to do and how to talk to our kids and our young people about this issue. So we welcome you. And last but most certainly not least, we want to welcome the members of the tobacco industry and the hookah lobby. We know you here. So welcome. We hope you change your life and change your behavior after you hear the information that we have to share here today. So without further ado, I am going to turn things over to I take that back with a little bit of ado. Further in my welcome, I want to make sure that I let you know who you're going to be seeing here today. So first and foremost, we have, of course, the co-founders of the AATCLC. We have Carol Magruder, who is a seasoned veteran of California's tobacco control experience and a founding member and chairperson of the AATCLC. She's received many honors and accolades from organizations including the Public Health Law Center, SRNT, the American Legacy Foundation, and the San Francisco and Berkeley branches of the NAACP. She also served as the NAACP branch president in Berkeley for more than two terms. Also speaking to you today will be Dr. Philip Gardner. He is a public health activist as well as an administrator and evaluator and researcher. He recently retired from a long career with the Tobacco-Related Disease Research Program at the University of California in the Office of the President, where during his distinguished career, he worked on studies ranging from hypertension, multiculturalism, AIDS, to breast cancer and prostate cancer, diabetes, and smoking. For the past 20 years, Dr. Gardner has lectured around the country on African-American health disparities and generally, and menthol smoking in the Black community. In particular, Dr. Gardner is currently the co-chair of the AATCLC. Coming to you today also is Dr. Stephen Milner. Now, he has a special place in my heart. He was one of my professors at San Jose State. So he is a beloved professor emeritus at San Jose State, and he earned a degree at San Jose State before attending UC Berkeley to earn a doctorate in sociology. He's the senior editor of a recent book called California's Changing Majority, Historic and Contemporary Dynamics, and which is now in its third edition. And he was among the first African-Americans to teach full-time at the University of Mississippi. He also served as chair of San Jose State's African-American Studies Department for many years, and he is a beloved community figure. So welcome, Dr. Milner. We also want to welcome Dr. Wael Al-Dulaimi. He is a multidisciplinary epidemiologist with a medical background in chronic diseases and tobacco and diet in the environment. He practiced medicine in his native Iraq and then Jordan between 1991 and 1995, before finishing his doctorate, his PhD at Otago University in New Zealand in the year 2000. He's been involved in tobacco control research for more than 25 years and led the tobacco control surveys, and more recently leads the California American Indian Tobacco Initiative evaluation. His tobacco research focused on biomarkers, policy, hookah, and e-cigarettes. So we have quite a authority on the subject matter here with us. And Dr. Al-Dulaimi, welcome. We are also welcoming Dr. Arnab Mukherjee. He's an associate professor and incoming chair of the Department of Health Science and Public and Community Health at California State University East Bay, previously known as Cal State Hayward. Dr. Mukherjee's applied research interests broadly revolve around using community-engaged methods to understand and address health disparities among understudied Asian and Pacific Islander subgroups. He has a particular focus on contextual and culturally framed risk factors among South Asians in the United States. So Dr. Mukherjee is going to be moderating the discussion between our scholars a little later. So we're so happy to welcome you here. So without further ado now, I will hand things over to our co-chair, Carol Magruder.
Yes, ma'am.
All righty. So I'm Carol Magruder. I'm one of the co-chairs of the African American Tobacco Control Leadership Council. Welcome. And I'm just going to spend a few minutes talking about the purpose of why we're here today. The African American Tobacco Control Leadership Council, we have been working steadily for over a decade, more than that, but officially over a decade, to get mentholated tobacco products off of the market, particularly Newport cigarettes and Kools and Salems that were left in when the Tobacco Control Act was signed in 2009. And as we've been doing our work in cities and counties and states across the country, we have seen the proliferation of hookah and hookah lounges. And when the Hookah Chamber of Commerce would come to testify before before elected officials, city councils, and supervisors in the county level, they would bring this beautiful, magnificent traditional hookah pipe, water pipe that's big and bulky and beautiful, and they would talk about their culture and why the hookah lounges and the hookah proportion or component of the commercial tobacco industry, why they needed to be exempted and not be have their flavors and their products taken off the market as flavored tobacco, other flavored tobacco products. And while this was a beautiful demonstration of culture, we saw the similarities of how culture was being used to keep these deadly products on the market, as people were saying, and some of our own African-American leaders were saying that African-Americans had a cultural affinity for mentholated tobacco products. So our wonderful program manager, Tracy Brown, came up with this concept to have our scholars come in and to weigh in so that when we make public health policy, when we enact laws and ordinances, it's done from a scientific and correct historical basis and not on the basis of emotion or because something is beautiful and looks good. When we've seen the proliferation of these hookah lounges, I started really noticing them with my daughter in Atlanta, who's a HBCU grad, when I would go down there and I'm seeing all of our young African-American college students and young professionals smoking hookah. And so that's when we knew that this was really just spreading across the country. And even I'm learning as we've been gathering the information for today, how wide it has spread even more than I thought, which I knew that it was out there. So I'm glad to have our scholars here today to give some weigh-in on these issues. I talk about the racial overlay of tobacco control in the United States and that we need to have family conversations, especially in our African-American community. So we're broadening that family conversation today so that we can look at this from different angles and we can make our legislation and the laws that we use to protect our children and young people from the basis of correct historical information and scientific data. So with that, I will pass it back. And I'm hearing our conversation today and seeing what our scholars have to say.
Okay. I am a trained sociologist, but also a social historian. And when I think about issues like tobacco and the African-American community, I also think about where it all started. And that's especially appropriate for us to ponder that because it started in the state of Virginia, and tobacco and African Americans, tobacco as a cash crop started there in 1612, but it became the largest cash crop in Virginia in 1619. And it's no coincidence that that's the first year that African slaves were imported to the British colonies. And when you talk about tobacco, you have to talk about colonialism and the era of slavery. And Virginia is close to my heart. And in some respects, it heartbreaks me because my slave ancestors served on tobacco farms outside of Danville, Virginia. And every generation of milliners until my generation, we were deeply manipulated and in many respects controlled by tobacco. My father was a smoker. He attended Ohio State, but he also went to East High School in Columbus, Ohio, and started smoking when he was 14 years old. And by the time he was 20 years old, he was smoking a pack a day. And that's because he came of age shortly after World War I. And cigarette use exploded with the war. World War I, soldiers got free cigarettes. And African Americans were deeply involved in that. At any rate, I came of age being well aware of tobacco and our connection to it, because I was well aware about slavery. But slavery and tobacco go together. Virginia would be the centerpiece for where laws that controlled slaves originated. And then they would spread throughout the South and then throughout the country and ultimately throughout the world. Tobacco is horrific in a lot of ways in terms of it being the first cash crop that made slavery such a deeply embedded institution in this society. And when we think about Virginia, we also have to ponder that four of the first six US presidents came from the state of Virginia, and they all had many things in common. But part of that was they were all tobacco plantation masters and masters of hundreds and ultimately thousands and the fate of thousands and then millions of Africans who became enslaved in this setting. In a few more minutes, you'll be seeing some videos that also deal with the culture of manipulation. And that will focus on the role of music and musicians and the legacy of jazz in this tobacco kind of approach to life. So as you see that, also do a couple of other things. Think about the impact of tobacco in all its various forms on life expectancy. In the video, you'll see some marvelous jazz performers, but each and every one of them was exposed to tobacco in the nightclub business. And the secondhand smoke is also something to ponder. My father, coming of age in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, had a life expectancy that he never came close to. He died at age 70, in part because of his 50 or more years of tobacco use. My wonderful mother, who never smoked a cigarette in her life, also contracted secondhand smoke, and she died from lung cancer at age 75. All of her side of my family typically lived into their 80s or 90s, but being a good wife and a female who was loyal to her man, who was loyal to tobacco, she ultimately paid an ultimate price as well. These are all issues that are personal, but they're also very important to our community and the nation's community and the world's community. So I'll turn it back now to Tracy and we'll move on. But these are matters that are really important, especially in places like the American South. And I hope some people in the South are watching and thinking about the impact that policy can have on preventing the spread of this tobacco plague.
Thank you so much, Dr. Milner. Now we are going to actually turn things over to Dr. Wael Al-Dulaimi.
Thank you, Tracy. I have the pleasure and honor to be on this panel and in this discussion, and going to talk more about hookah as the connection to what Dr. Milner kind of started. Everybody can see my slides?
Yes.
Great. Okay. So, sorry. So here are some, I'm pretty sure all of you have seen the hookah and know what it is because that's become so prevalent. But basically it has this top head where you put the tobacco and the coal and it burns and then people suck the air so that the smoke goes through these bubbled water and then to the person inhaling it. And so that's kind of the traditional one. And there are many forms from that now. And basically the hookah produces almost 10 times that of a cigarette because people stay about an hour long and using the pipe, the water pipe or the hookah. So it's more problematic, especially if somebody is using more than one session. And it's similar to the cigarettes in terms of the components. It also has coal that is burning that is not in cigarettes, and that produces carbon monoxide. Also, there's these sugar molasses produced, and when they burn, and you know, to give it a taste and the aroma, and when they burn, they actually produce more carcinogens than tobacco by itself. So this is an added problem. It's addictive, I can tell you. I have seen it and know people who are addicted to it. They cannot go without having at least one or two times of hookah settings a day. They have been shown to be related to cancer, all type of cancer, oral, lung, stomach, related to heart disease, low birth weight among infants to mothers who smoke hookah. And also the mouthpiece can spread the infection because in many cases it's shared by people. And you know, with COVID-19 and other infectious diseases, this is a big problem that really is not mitigated by just changing the mouthpiece. That's not enough because the tube is going to be the same tube that people are breathing in. Also, those people who are not smoking it but around it are being exposed to secondhand smoke, that's for sure. In the US, on average, about 12% of young adults report using it in the past year, and up to 20% in large cities. So in large metropolitan cities, there's more use of this. And in high school students, about 7.8% of them use it. And now we have different forms like electronic, portable, and other forms that is, you know, adding to the niche and the excitement about this hookah that goes way beyond what the traditional hookah was supposed to be. In addition, that is not part of the tradition of this use of tobacco is that there are flavors. Everything from chocolate to cappuccino to licorice to watermelon, you name it. It's just their imagination, and the chemicals that are put there are also not regulated for being inhaled, that's for sure. And they are being used very you know, widely for this. The industry of hookah is using the same tools that the tobacco industry has traditionally used. So adding flavors to lure the young and otherwise non-smokers as a way of getting them addicted to tobacco. There has been a paradigm shift away from tobacco in the last decade, thanks to programs like the California Tobacco Control Program and other programs. The social norm has shifted away from the cigarette. So the hookah is a way to bring it back again as something that is cool. Those of you who are old enough know the Joe Camel campaign showing that it is cool to smoke cigarettes, and it was targeting young folks in 1987 until it was stopped by law in 1997. And that's kind of appearing now through the hookah, that it is for, you know, happiness, friendliness, being wild and having fun with these kind of images about hookah. In addition, there's a connection here with being cool and the mint flavored and other products that are targeting the Black community of the US and the world. So you can see these connections coming back, and also the misuse of culture. So what are the hookah use myths? First, that it is less harmful than cigarettes. As we discussed, it is not, but that's a myth that is widely spread by the users as well as the producers. The other myth is that water clears then cleans the smoke, which is not true. The air goes through the water and it still has all the components that is inhaled to the lung. So nothing is pure about the water cleaning it. The smell of fruit and aroma suggests that it has nothing harmful, which is again, a totally wrong information. And then what we're talking about today is that it's part of the heritage and the culture of the Middle East. And this is a hookah lounge. You can see how it looks very traditional and very, you know, culturally relevant. And it is not actually part of the culture. So who speaks for the culture? And that's kind of the thing that we wanna relate to people who are here, and including those who are coming from the tobacco industry. They need to listen to this and learn that the culture is a set of norms agreed upon by the majority of a group of specific population. That's one of culture. It can be that people who are selling these products who speak for the culture. So those from the Middle East who are making a living out of selling hookah or running hookah lounges do not speak for the culture. They are speaking for their own business and profit. So that's something very important to differentiate. And so what is needed and why we are talking today about this? We need to address this from different perspectives and address this misuse of industry about the culture. First of all, if anybody is going to raise this issue of the culture, ask them about their conflict of interest. Let them declare it, whether it's in a public or in a setting. Do you have a lounge? Do you smoke hookah or use hookah? Because that by itself is a self, self-conflict or interest of conflict, just like we were asking smokers back in the 70s not to smoke. And there are smokers, they're addicted. So that's one thing we need to address. Ask them, why were cigarettes used and still used more than hookah among the older generation of those people of this descent from Middle East? If this is part of the culture, why isn't hookah used more than cigarettes? We know cigarettes use is epidemic in the Middle East and among those people who are of Middle Eastern descent here. They are higher users of cigarettes than hookah, that's for sure. So that defies or undermines this kind of claim that it is part of the culture, because it is not. This is an important historical thing that no one, not even the tobacco industry, can undermine. If hookah traced hundreds and thousands of years to the Middle East, when it was discovered in North America, how can tobacco being discovered in North America, which is a fact nobody can deny historically, be part of a tradition of the Middle East, which goes thousands of years ago? Thousands of years, the Middle Eastern population was established from the Babylonians and afterwards. So it doesn't make sense. What happens is that this was introduced later on by colonial powers and mostly the Turkish empire to that region from Europe. So they got it from Europe. And then again, not allow those to falsely speak for the whole culture, that is, and say that independent people from the region who live there told you this is not part of the culture. I can tell you, I lived in that region as an adult, as a physician, and it was never part of the culture, that it was something looked down at. Cigarettes were part of the culture. You know, a lot of people smoked, but that doesn't mean it is part of the original culture of that region. And so that's something to really know. It became a trend probably a decade ago by lounges and cafes and selling hookah, but it's not part of the culture. So, and then finally, we need to come together with research and evaluation projects to address this phenomena. And also the target communities should be working together like we are doing now, because there's power in unity. And I want to end with a story that shows why we really need to work together. And that I kind of saw recently in the Union Tribune, San Diego Union Tribune, that Arab Americans and Black Americans are coming together to address discrimination against them. And this is really something we need to do as communities against the industry. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Al-Dulaimi. Next, we will hear from Dr. Phil about the science of hookah.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, all. as pointed out, I'm Dr. Philip Gardner, co-chair of the African American Tobacco Control Leadership Council. Let me just say, what I'm going to do today is try and focus on the question of flavors, because that is the key link between shisha and Newport cigarettes, is essentially the tobacco industry's main attraction. So let me kind of jump into this. And I really like the title, The Culture of Manipulation, How Tobacco Profiteer Uses Culture to Con Us. Last point of that Wahl made was right on point. And it was the to tie it all together, it was the tobacco farmers who were with African slaves producing the tobacco products that were taken by the British to Turkey and to India that introduced this to our people. But we can talk about that on the other side. If you take anything home from what I'm saying today, it's this, that flavorings are not for inhalation. Usually they're thought of generally recognized as safe. That's what GRAS means. Aldehydes, that's what flavorings are. Aldehydes are toxicologically primary irritants of the mucosa of the respiratory tract. That's what the thing is. The lungs have a different spectrum of toxicity than the intestinal tract. Substances known to be safe when swallowed can be dangerous when inhaled. Okay, so what ties these flavors together? They cause respiratory inflammation, impairs immune cell functions, deregulates antitoxin responses, increases susceptibility to infection, and of course contribute to emphysema and COPD. The ultimate candy flavoring, menthol, punchline is it helps the poison go down easier. It's chief constituent of peppermint oil. It provides a cooling sensation. It has an anesthetic effect, a numbing effect that allows for deeper inhalation. We know that the more deeper you inhale, the more nicotine you intake, the more addicted you become. We know that people who smoke mentholated cigarettes, it inhibits nicotine metabolism in your liver. When nicotine gets to your liver, it's called cotinine. If you've been smoking a menthol cigarette, the cotinine will not metabolize as fast because menthol slows it down. Big word, independent sensory activation of neurotransmitter. The punchline here is that people who smoke menthol cigarettes produce more nicotine receptors in their brain. And given those more nicotine receptors in their brain, they need to fill them up even more. This leads to, of course, if you have more of them in their brain, it makes it harder to quit. And probably most problematic is greater cell permeability. When you have menthol in something, in smoke, it penetrates the cell membrane much more efficiently than if there isn't menthol in it. So this is what flavorings do. And I just want to be clear. I know Tracy said it was going to be the science of hookah. No, this is the science of flavors and what links the relationship between hookah and cigarettes is it's the flavors. So where are we today with this? And I just want, this is a major take home. About half of all high school smokers use menthol cigarettes. Over 500,000 kids, middle and high schoolers, use menthol cigarettes. This is the attraction, is the flavor. Where are we today? This is has to do with this study that 50% in the past 30 day youth cigarette smoking reported smoking menthol cigarettes. These recent studies, 50%, well, 49.5 report smoking that, and that the highest and that menthol smokers have the highest nicotine dependence scores. So flavors are playing an important role in this whole thing. So flavors are us. With the coming of electronic cigarettes and the market being flooded, we begin to see their use everywhere. You can see the first generations were Cigalites, the second generation were Tanks, and of course the third generation was Juul. And now because Juul got kind of busted, Puff Bar and other likes are on the market. we've come to find out that there are certain flavors in cigarettes and in electronic cigarettes that are essentially deadly. And diacetyl, what we've come to know as popcorn lung, diacetyl gives a flavor that stimulates, you know, kind of tastes buttery or yogurt or has fruit flavor. It actually, in a plant, in a microwave popcorn plant in Missouri about 5 years ago, a number of the diacetyl exposure to four or five workers was so severe that one person died and that four were hospitalized and couldn't return to work. Diacetyl has been found in many e-cigarette vapors, especially sweet vapors. Diacetyl, keep that in mind. Cinnamonaldehyde is another flavor that is in e-cigarettes. Suppresses bronchial epithelial cells, cellular motility, it deregulates mitochondrial function. With essential respiratory defenses down, inhalation of cinnamaldehyde may increase the risk of respiratory defection in cigarette users. Notice these are recent studies. This is what kids are using, whether it's menthol cigarettes, e-cigarettes, and we'll do hookah here in a minute. This is what's kind of going on. Here's a study that looked at 51 types of flavors in e-cigarettes. Diacetyl was found in 39 of the 51. This is what kids are using. Again, another study looking at 159 distinct liquids and aerosols were analyzed. Nearly 75% of the samples had diacetyl in them. I had to look this up when I first saw this, is that the combination of the viscosity of e-liquids and some classes of chemicals and sweet flavors may increase the risk of cariogenic potential. The punchline is if you use some type of flavored e-cigarettes, it can lead to more cavities in your teeth. Flavors. Where are we today? Approximately half of ever flavor users report that they use the same flavor across products. Menthol users were the highest at 52%. E-pens and e-hookahs. Now, why this is important, a lot of hookah, these new contraptions that are coming out are saying, well, there's no tobacco and there's just flavors like cherry, chocolate, vanilla, and bubblegum. The flavors, again, and this is why we started the discussion with this, are aldehydes. These aldehydes are not good for you, and they're respiratory irritants. And so they're even bad for kids, whether they have nicotine in them or not. We've already seen the picture of the hookah, how that works. I won't go back through that. As pointed out, there's 10 times the amount of carbon monoxide, 25 times the amount of tar. It's really outrageous. Wild did this already. This is just another one. Looking into this, I like to keep my citations, kind of current. So I just did this again. What was amazing to me about this is the amount of lead that is found in hookah products when smoked. Hookah lounges, it's all about, people were going to say it's all about the culture, it's all about friendship, it's all about that, it's all about the flavors. And even though, we've talked about this some. Let's just look at this. It's the hookah lounge, or volume hookah lounge. That's actually the name, is volume hookah lounge. These are the things that are on the menu at the hookah lounge. This isn't about culture. This is about profit. The same thing. And here we go. Queen of Sex, Sex on the Beach, Safari Mildew Melon. This is what's going on in terms of the flavor thing. Where are we today in the United States? 90% of youth who use tobacco when smoking a water pipe use flavors. And we see that 43% of use of tobacco in the past 30 days, e-cigarettes and water pipe were the third most common when you put products in combination. E-cigarettes and hookahs, just as Al said it, earlier, that this is gaining more popularity today. And the key thing in the popularity is the flavor. Okay. The take-home message, whether it's cigarettes, shisha, cigars, cigarillos, e-juices, or any other tobacco product, menthol in all flavors makes the poison go down easier. And with that, I'll stop. Again, thank you for your time. I'm looking forward to the discussion with our scholars. And I'll stop my share screen.
All right, Nicole, take us into our video.
All right, will do. Thank you, Tracy. And thank you to all of our scholars who have spoken so far. Next up, I will be playing a video which I put together to demonstrate the tactics that tobacco profiteers, the tobacco industry, and now the hookah industry are using to really misconstrue the arguments that are out there to support strong public health policy that would include all flavored tobacco products, including menthol and hookah. So please, everyone, tune into this video that is going to go in depth on some of these narratives while also pretty much refuting them and providing the counter evidence needed to support the opposite.
Tobacco-related diseases are still the number one cause of death in the African-American community, and that's not a coincidence. I learned that the tobacco industry strategically and successfully infiltrated my community. And while it's true that they targeted many groups, the targeting of the Black community has been uniquely damaging.
Critics charge that the tobacco companies view Black smokers as a growing source of income. In fact, they say, Blacks are the target of carefully plotted and highly specific marketing campaigns.
For decades, the tobacco companies have used predatory practices aimed to push their deadly product onto the Black community.
The death rates for African Americans who smoke hover around 49,000 per year. It's no accident that African Americans smoke more menthol cigarettes.
One of the greatest marketing coups that took place in the 20th century is transforming menthol cigarette into a Black cigarette. The tobacco industry, particularly some of them, began to realize we could market a particular brand to this group of people. Brown and Williamson conducted a number of focus groups in the late 50s and early 60s that identified that African Americans were more receptive to TV commercials, more receptive to the messages that are provided there. They began to use Black images on television and in their ads. In 1953, 5% of African Americans used menthol products compared to 3% for whites. By 1968, that had tripled to 14%. By 1976, it had tripled again to over 42%. Into the 2000s, we're above 80%. That's the African Americanization of menthol cigarettes in the United States.
In Oakland, Javon Lee says he began smoking sweet-flavored tobaccos as a kid.
They like that flavor stuff, like with the e-cigarettes. Strawberry, pineapple, cupcake, ice cream, you know, so they like
them,
that.
Does that get them started on smoking?
I'm gonna say yeah.
One out of every five children in our country are now current smokers by the time they leave high school. Each day, 1,000 young people under the age of 18 become new, regular, daily smokers. And almost 90% of all smokers began at or before their 18th birthday. I know I was one of these teenagers, and so I know how difficult it can be to break this habit when it's been with you for a long time. And I also know that kids today don't just start smoking for no reason. They're aggressively targeted as customers by the tobacco industry. Today, change has come to Washington. This legislation will not ban all tobacco products, and it will allow adults to make their own choices.
Cigarettes that white smokers prefer will be legal in California. If someone wanted to go to a hookah shop, which is not in the Black community, will be legal.
And it's very, very important, again, that we understand that unintended consequences will create terrible effects within our community.
Enough is enough. We cannot have this. This is uncalled for. This is something that we don't need. This bill, again, is going to create a Black market in our community.
You cannot deny one group something that another group has. We have been saying, for justice, you ought to ban them all, or don't ban the sale of them all, or ban them at all. And now this whole issue around hookah.
Hookah is a part of a cultural heritage that has been around for nearly 1,000 years. And we ask that traditional hookah be granted a cultural exemption.
Save hookah, please.
Hookah, also known as shisha, involves adults smoking a flavored tobacco from a water pipe in which they pass a hose and take a puff among family or friends. Hookah is deeply rooted in a cultural tradition that has been present throughout generations among Indian, Persian, Turkish, Egyptian, and other Middle Eastern families.
By mixing honey or molasses with the tobacco, mahassal translates directly as with honey. This term generally refers to flavored tobacco. Even dried fruits like lemon, grape, watermelon, and mint were eventually added. Hookah integrated into society so deeply in these parts that hookah cafes were built to house the ever-growing popularity.
In the early 21st century, a hookah industry surfaced in the United States as early pioneers found ways to improve the quality of products using modern technology. Innovations in flavors choices beyond the traditional were also crafted to address the demands of current day taste preference and variety. Today, in the United States and around the world, hookah has hardly broke from tradition, as it is still revered as a way to show respect and provide good hospitality, as it was hundreds of years ago.
I'm gonna add the flavor all around the hair and leave this hole in the middle. I think the key to the flavor is fluffing it out as you're like spreading it throughout.
Baby, pay me the hook. Woo! Baby, pay me the hook. Yeah. Baby, pay me the hook. Hey, baby, just play me the hook.
I'm saying it look cool, don't it? I'm gonna give y'all step one of don't. If you do not smoke hookah regularly and you hit this and your tolerance ain't built up for that, you might faint. You might tip over.
Baby, pay me the hook.
Yeah.
Baby, pay me the hook. Baby, pay me the hook. Hey, baby, just play me the hook. Baby, pay me the hook.
All right. So hopefully people were better able to get an idea and understanding of some of the narratives that tobacco profiteers are using to misguide this conversation. And so at this time, we'll pass it back to our scholars to really address this issue in more detail and further refute some of these narratives.
Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, friends, and perhaps foes. I am wonderfully humbled to be able to join these wonderful folks today in discussion with you. And I do want to emphasize that this is a true example of solidarity across communities. And I think we are hopefully providing an avenue where as we navigate out of this pandemic world and resume the inequities that plague many of our communities, that we can come together with shared purpose to be able to combat the common enemy and not each other. And I hope that all of us in the audience embrace that challenge as we go along. My name is Arnav Mukherjee. I am an associate professor at California State University, East Bay. I am pleased to have the honor of moderating this session. My own work in the tobacco control field has largely been struggling around many of these issues, which is what is culture? What is culturally appropriate behavioral patterns? How does it relate and how do we change those to advance health equity and reduce disparities? And then how do we combat the commercialization of harm and risk and profiting to cause death and disease among communities that are already disenfranchised or vulnerable? In the South Asian community, much of the tobacco use revolves around the use of smokeless products, combinations of betel nut and tobacco. They do have a cultural origin. They do have a cultural narrative that's associated with it. But what we're seeing more and more often in India and the broader South Asian subcontinent is the corporate interests that define how those things are manufactured, mass manufactured, sold very cheaply, avoiding issues of taxation, avoiding many of the things that effective tobacco control policy has begun to do in reducing at least the prevalence of cigarettes and other forms of smoke products in the community. So with that, you know, I'm so happy to bring my African-American brothers and sisters and my Middle Eastern brothers and sisters together, because the common enemy is not a hookah or a menthol cigarette. The common enemy is the industry. And we have to remember that. And let's come together to do that. So with that, I am going to go ahead and start the conversation with some questions. And thank you for those of you that have submitted questions prior to the event and also that are coming in right now. So I get to play the DJ in an academic sense. And the first question I'll ask, since we just ended with a wonderful montage on the narrative, if you will, is Dr. Delaimi, can you tell us a little bit about the risk profile, what we know about morbidity and mortality regarding hookah use in the Middle East, as far as we know, and the attributable risk to hookah smoking?
Yes, thank you, Arnab. So the data on hookah use in the Middle East is not overwhelming, and there isn't a lot of research because research requires funding. And funding for research is very limited in these regions. So the data is mostly descriptive, and to really demonstrate the impacts in that region, we need to, you know, have people who have been smoking it and follow them up over a period of several years to see the outcome. But we do have studies from the US and from Europe about hookah use impacts, as well as from laboratory analysis and studies mentioned by Dr. Gardner that shows that the impacts are similar and the associations are similar. And why wouldn't it be similar? Because it's tobacco. Both of them are tobacco and both of them are burnt. And we do know that the long-term impacts, the longer people use it, the more regular. So there's duration and intensity. So all of these can cause the same risk for heart disease, cancers, and so on. The other thing to know of is that somebody might say, I am just using hookah on weekends. Well, it's just like somebody saying, I occasionally smoke. Unfortunately, based on very rigorous and well-established studies, it sometimes takes, you know, several sessions, not always smoking, but even occasional smoking can trigger the carcinogenic process of lung cancer and other cancers. So these carcinogens are going to start and trigger and then produce these impacts. In addition, as I mentioned, the problem with hookah is that the amount of smoke that is smoked is much more than a cigarette. And with it is carbon monoxide from the coal. And so there are definitely some higher risk, but we don't have quantification from the Middle East.
Thank you, Wael. Dr. Milner, if I may, moving to sort of the role of industry and community organizations that claim to represent our communities. A question came in earlier. Why is it that the largest, our largest organizations, and I'm assuming this is reflective of the African-American community, why is it that our largest organizations are complicit in harming African-Americans? For example, Noble. And so if you could talk more about community-based organizations and what their role is, either for or against sort of health equity in our populations.
Well, community organizations are not beyond criticism, and that includes self-criticism. Whether it's the NAACP, which I've been a member of since I was 15 years old, or Black churches or Black fraternities and political organizations. I belong to a Black fraternity, but we have been very self-critical, and we've stopped some of the cultural practices that we, you know, once engaged in. I'm a what is called an Omega, and we used to have these kinds of activities that we called smokers, and it entailed just that, welcoming in people who were going to be considering joining the organization, and we would have a social activity that involved all kinds of behaviors, including, you know, what goes on in a smoker. And those things, you know, are things that we as a community and we as a nation need to be very self-critical about. Black musicians have often found themselves pushed into workplaces that are just habitually dangerous. Secondhand smoke in bars in the 40s and 50s and 60s turned out to be devastating for some of the most important musicians that this society has ever created. They lost a lot of their artistic years through premature death. And just as sure as we are spending a Friday afternoon thinking about these serious issues, there are folks who are going to become deeply exposed and prematurely addicted to tobacco through both hookah and cheap menthol cigarettes. And some people are simply bought off. The Black community is very diverse. We are more than 40 million in our numbers. And that means there are all kinds of different, you know, African-Americans with different opinions. And some will take what I would, you know, attribute it as something that might be close to a bribe, political contributions, all kinds of things that will move policy in ways that are not always positive. So in that respect, everything has changed, but nothing has changed.
We also have a contribution from Carol Magruder.
Yes, I wanted to add in, we have seen great change, thank God. And I, from when Dr. Valerie Yerger wrote her seminal paper, Smoking with the Enemy, that really documented how the tobacco industry just went after our African-American organizations and leadership groups perniciously. And all the groups used to take money, and that has changed. And most notably, Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, our wonderful sistership organization of professional African-American women in this country, was one of the first organization on that stature to take a stand and ask the FDA to take menthol off the market. And since that time, they have had other resolutions about local work that the local branches and chapters can do. And then the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People had a national resolution passed in 2016 after the Deltas, and they have steadfast. They refuse to accept money from Juul. And so you'll see different variances because, you know, there's the national level, the state level, as you know, I'm a member as well. And so, but nationally, national is holding firm and is very involved in all of our efforts across the country to get Newports and flavored tobacco out of the Black community. And so we see the industry stepping up their cultivation of other groups, but there are some major significant groups, including the National Medical Association that joined our lawsuit. So we're seeing a shift, and we need the shift to keep shifting in the way of the people.
Thank you, Carol. I appreciate you showing that, you know, our organizations are indeed evolving to a lens of equity. Dr. Al-Dalaimi, I know you referred to this in your presentation, but just to be clear for the audience members, is there any religious or cultural significance to unflavored hookah from a historical or even current perspective in your personal experience and your scholarly activities?
The short answer is no. And as a matter of fact, as the majority of that region are Muslim, or more than 92 or 95%, Islam prohibits any self-harm. So once it was evident in the 50s and 60s, or actually in the 60s, that tobacco use is harmful and can cause death, it becomes forbidden. Tobacco use is forbidden for Muslims to use. That includes hookah, that includes cigarettes, that includes anything that is tobacco. However, when I raise this issue with people, and I can tell you almost all very well practicing Muslims do not smoke in any kind of form. But when I raise it with others, they say, well, it is maybe not forbidden. Maybe it's discouraged, because they based it on earlier Muslims before they knew that hookah was harmful or cigarettes was harmful, and they didn't make it forbidden. But once the evidence was there, it was forbidden. So there is no religious in any way connection. In terms of the culture, as I mentioned, I grew up in that region, and there were some elderly who used it, you know, just like some elderly, like my grandfather, used to roll their own, you know, before the manufacture of cigarettes were happening, and he was used to that. So that doesn't give it any cultural aspect, and people look down at, hookah is for older folks who, you know, pre-cigarette manufacturing. So the question is, if it was cultural again, why did it appear again? If it wasn't cultural, why did it appear again? It appeared because of the adding of the flavors in the last decades, where it became more interesting, smelling nice, and the young folks got interest, and then there was a business out of that. So it has nothing to do with the tradition or the culture.
And if I can continue on this thread, are you aware either internationally, in my own work, I see a lot of the manufacturers of snus are now targeting the Indian smokeless tobacco, the indigenous products, if you will. Are you aware either internationally or domestically, for instance, Farah in the audience says, the CEO of Al Fakhr is also from British American Tobacco. Are you aware of corporate interests that are pushing hookah commercialization?
You know, the big industry are not gonna invest until they see there's a good profit in business, right? So look at the e-cigarettes. It was invented by somebody in China, you know, and then small companies. And then when it became popular, big industry came in and bought in, you know, percentages of Juul or others. Same thing with hookah. Once there's a profit in the business, which is now hookah is becoming, then they jump in and you know, have their hands on it. So I'm pretty sure that industry has something to do with this, as well as now it has its own industry of the hookah commerce chamber or something like that. You know, they're all faces for the same industry.
Thank you, Ael. Dr. Milner, I'm going to feign ignorance on this, but you are the historian, so I was the student. Jose asks, can anyone discuss the marketing strategies that Edward Bernays, 1929, Torches of Freedom used, and how that's still being used to influence people of color and poor folks, and how this form of marketing has now flourished?
Well, I would just say that the video that we watched about a half hour ago gave very vivid examples of the history of advertising in the Black community and in the national community. I'm not familiar with that particular incident, but I'm not going to be surprised by anything. The misuse of our athletic heroes, the cultivation of our political heroes and sheroes, those are all things that are both historic and contemporary. And we need to be open and honest about that. When you see baseball players in the 1940s and 50s, the first generation that was allowed to play white Major League Baseball, they almost immediately got co-opted and offered cheap salaries for advertising cigarettes. So those things never surprise me. It's important to note that big events always have an impact on tobacco use. World War I, soldiers from around the globe got access to cheap tobacco and they came back transformed. That was in cigarettes. Cigarettes have their own history. That's the cheapest tobacco that came out of the unused cigar tobacco. Snuff, all that stuff has been pushed on our communities over generations of time. So none of that surprises me, and it's going to be a real battle going forward with zoning regulations and things like that. When I first arrived in California, I arrived in a place called South Central Los Angeles. South Central Los Angeles, when I got there in the early 60s, had more than 712 liquor store outlets within a 60 block radius. And all those liquor stores were also tobacco shops. And that's always been the case. And Muslims always impressed me because they talked about no use of alcohol or tobacco. And I watched their discipline. And that was very impressive.
Thank you. This is a question for both of you. You know, we're talking a lot about our role and responsibilities within the community setting. But also public policy plays a role. Public policy is very important for public health, as we are learning right now. So the question that has been asked is, do you think that taxing hookah, vapes, other forms of tobacco or flavoring, is that an appropriate policy level intervention, or does it wind up being regressive to the exact communities based on social and economic disadvantage? I will let whoever wants to take that first.
Any tactic that brings a halt or diminishes the use of either tobacco or hookah, as far as I'm concerned, is should be considered. I used to use the analogy that the city of Oakland, and I was very familiar with it having spent 10 years at Berkeley, the west side and the east side, deep west Oakland and east Oakland, in the 1980s, there used to be a monthly drain of almost $30 million a month for cannabis use. And I didn't have the numbers for tobacco use, but it was similar. And it's all a drain from people who, if you say that Black Lives Matter, then you've got to stand against this nonsense, because addictions also matter to those who are poorest. And my father always found enough money for his cigarettes, but he didn't always find enough money for me to get two hot dogs on Friday. I usually had to get only one, but there was always that money for cigarette use. And I'm sure that there are people who are going to, you know, be crippled economically from addictions to these modern tobacco products. So anything that can stop it, I say, needs to be at least considered.
Dr. Al-Dulaimi, did you have a thought on this?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's well-proven policies of tobacco control that, you know, a single policy by itself doesn't work. So if you have increased taxes, you also have to have banning of flavoring so it doesn't target the young. There is education and addiction treatment. So it has to all come one in hand, but definitely making it cheaper doesn't help. And not having a tax doesn't help because it makes it easier for people. So I think I would support any decision, as Dr. Milner said.
Thank you for that. This question came up prior to our session. It is brought up in the chat room. I think it's important. How can someone appropriately message this, and I will broaden that to advocate out, you know, and serve as an ally, if they're not from the community that the community, not from the community that is being targeted? And to follow up on that, how can they help in the cause without invoking white saviorism? So a very complicated one. Dr. Al-Dulaimi, I'll start with you on this one. And then Dr. Milner, please do respond.
Yes, again, I think it's like we do research with communities of different culture. You need to have first an understanding of that culture. And second, you need to have allies from that culture so that you don't kind of speak on behalf of that culture, whether it's Arab, whether it's Black, whether it's a Latino, whatever it is. You need to have that collaboration. And I, you know, that's why I kind of really was enthusiastically supportive of this kind of event, because as far as I know, for the first time, bringing these two cultures together to address a common problem. Something that is relevant that happened many, many years ago, but I think it's relevant here. And in the US, there's always a discrimination and targeting of, by one community versus another. But the problem is other communities don't support the community that is targeted. And that is unfortunately part of this culture. In 1953, remember 1953, a young Arab student came to study in North Carolina. And he befriended another fellow Arab who's African. You know, Arabs have dark skin, like Sudan and others light skin. So that young person was light skin and his friend was dark skin. And so they went into the bus, and he saw that the bus, you know, if people are fair skin, they are in the front, and those who are dark skin in the back. He's not gonna leave his friend sitting there. So he went in solidarity and sat with him in the back. But the bus driver stopped the bus and said, "Hey, you," to him, to the fair skin, "you're in the front." And then he refused to do that. So the bus didn't wanna move until that person moved. And so there was an argument in, of course, broken English for that person coming, and they both in defiance stepped out of the bus. No one in the bus supported them. They had to have a long walk home because they couldn't afford a taxi. But the idea here is we have to, that person was my father. And he told us this story, how the segregation and how the discrimination based on color was foreign. And so we have to come and work together, whether it is discrimination, whether it is tobacco, whether it is anything, and come together those who are targeted communities. And that's why I feel like this is where it's helpful to talk across cultures and like this event.
Dr. Milner?
When it comes to strategies or allies to combat this false use of flavors, we need all the allies across ethnic lines and across gender lines and across all lines that we can get, because this really is a fight for people's economic future, their health future, and we're just starting this battle, and it's going to go on for some time. So no one should feel that they are foreign to this struggle. We welcome all, at least I can say that from my point of view.
I think that will be a nice note of solidarity to end this panel, this conversation. I'm going to turn it over to Nicole to take it from here, but I thank both of our esteemed guests for really giving a snapshot of what we can really do together and the power of solidarity. And I hope for the audience that this provides a pathway for us to do that in concert with each other and for social equity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mukherjee and Dr. Milner and Dr. Al-Dalami and all of our scholars who have spoken so far. We have reached the end of our formal program, but we will be having a few more minutes of discussion after this formal closing. So please, if you can, stay on with us. But to end, I would just like to do a little bit of announcements. So again, thank you all so much for attending our program. We hope you learned so much more about this important public health issue and that you're leaving with a better understanding of the misperceptions and profiteer-backed narratives surrounding flavored hookah and menthol cigarettes and the damage that these cause to otherwise life-saving public health legislation. The conversation on these issues does not end here. So everyone, please mark your calendars for May 16th, which is No Menthol Sunday. No Menthol Sunday is a nationally observed day led by the Center for Black Health and Equity. Its purpose is to engage faith leaders and their communities in a discussion about how to improve health conditions for African Americans as it relates to menthol and other flavored tobacco and vaping products. Tobacco is still the number one killer of African Americans, and people of faith can play a major role in changing this. So please visit nomentholsunday.org to download the community event toolkit and to reserve your special edition No Menthol Sunday face mask today. So once again, thank you so much for joining us. If you can, please stay for the additional conversation we'll have after this portion. But if not, please take 5 minutes to complete our post-event survey. You can pull out your phone right now and use your camera to take a snapshot of the QR code provided. The data from this survey really helps us to improve our future work. So please be honest and fill it out completely. Lastly, take a minute to follow us on your preferred social media platform, if you would, to stay engaged with us, learn more about tobacco-related issues, and to stay up to date on all the campaigns we have going in California as well as nationally. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole, so much for your words and for your work. I want to let folks know who put all the questions in the chat, in the Q&A, that we will be sending out responses to any questions that we don't get to. But now, just like Trevor Noah has his Beyond the Show, After the Show set, this is our after show for our scholars. Dr. Al-Dalami has another event, so he may have to pop out momentarily, but we have our other folks here for
a Tracy, can you put my camera on, please?
I'm coming, Dr. Phil. I can only do thing one thing at once. We all love Dr. Phil. We love our group here. So anyway, we are coming. Dr. Phil, go ahead and start your camera and we can have you up on screen. And go ahead and take away.
Thank you, everyone. And I'm sorry I have to leave for another commitment, but it's been a pleasure being part of this panel and look forward to answer any other further questions.
It doesn't start. Doesn't start, Trace.
Okay, that's okay, Dr. Phil. We'll get you taken care of. And if in the meantime, Dr. Milner, Dr. Mukherjee, and Carol are here.
Well, while we're getting Dr. Phil online, I just want to thank all of our participants today. This has just been such a wonderful, great discussion and the beginning of something great in terms of us working closer together to work to make all of our communities more united and healthier and stronger together. So I am just so encouraged. And I wanted to say that with the common marketing and targeting that we face, that this is the beginning. And there was something that I think Dr. Delamy said about, when we pass an ordinance, that's the beginning, that's not the end. And that we need programs for our people. The Civil Rights Bill, the Voting Rights Act was passed 50 some odd years ago. We're still fighting that fight. So we're not thinking that legislation is gonna be some magic bullet that's gonna change everything, but it's the beginning of the change that we wanna see along with many other things that we're working on. Dr. Phil, I'm gonna pass it over to you now that we have you back on.
Well, I've been trying to answer a number of questions in the chat. And one that kind of came up, and even though we may not remember it, the passing the torch was a term that the tobacco industry used in 1929 and 1930 to try and get women more interested in smoking. And what became clear to them, the first product that they said, let's try and get them to use the new cool product that came out in 1932. And what happened in the run-up to the 1960s, the majority of menthol smokers were essentially white women. What happens is the tobacco industry pivots in the late 50s and early 60s, as I mentioned in the film Black Lives, Black Lungs, and starts marketing heavily to African-Americans that by the time of 50 years later, it become a black cigarette, not only a black cigarette, particularly a black male cigarette. So I thought it was an excellent question. And there's still other ones in there that we could deal with if you want to, Arnav.
I will also comment similar to how, co-optation happens. Doing the work that I do in the South Asian community, it's interesting that the bidi, which again has gone thankfully out of vogue lately, but I remember about 10, 15 years ago, if you look at the cultural history of bidis in India and other parts of South Asia, it really was the poor person's cigarette because it was the person had to hand roll it, put in unrefined tobacco. And the industry was very skillful in marketing that as an exotic cultural, if you remember those days where bidis were sold at probably more expensively than cigarettes. So I think these patterns repeat themselves. The product changes and the people changes, but the harmer, the oppressor is still the same. And it's important to use history as our guide, as I think Dr. Milner will probably echo, that these stories are not new. The seats have just changed. And let's bring those seats together. And that's, and really counteract the people who are putting us in those positions. So there are some questions about the FDA and what they're doing. So I'm gonna open it up because I don't know if folks are very familiar with what the FDA's role is, but if Carol or Phil, for that matter, if you could tell us sort of where the FDA is with its oversight of tobacco products and where there needs to be more work, especially given the change in the administration. Carol, I'll ask you first.
I'll do the background, Carol, and okay, you can do the foreground.
Yeah. Okay.
I guess the punchline, it kind of has been said in 2009 when the FDA received oversight of tobacco products from Congress, the bill that the Congress passed and that Obama signed got rid of 13 flavors in cigarettes. The only flavor that was left was menthol. And that was what we're calling the original sin, the original racist sin that went on. Subsequently, a citizen's petition was filed in 2013 calling on the FDA to remove menthol from the marketplace because its own tobacco product scientific committee had found in 2011 that it was harmful to the public's health. in 2016, it was determined that they deemed all these other products, the e-cigarettes, the hookah, the little cigars, the cigarillos, the orbs, all of that under the province of the FDA. They wrote a 16-page appendix that actually went through in detail of why these new products should not have any flavors in them. That 16 pages was redlined by the Office on Management and Budget. We find ourselves today where finally in 2020, we filed suit against the FDA. And I'm going to leave it there. And Carol, you can pick up. The last year has been a ways. Go ahead.
So we filed an administrative lawsuit against the FDA, the African American Tobacco Control Leadership Council, joined by co-plaintiffs, initially ASH, Action on Smoking or Health. And then the American Medical Association joined in and the National Medical Association joined in. So we're now four co-plaintiffs and we're awaiting April 29th, the FDA has said they're going to say something about the citizens petition, and then we will see where we are. But we encourage everyone to continue to enact local legislation on the city, on the county, and on the state level until it's done. So one of the things that the industry does is delay. So we've been delayed since 2009. We're now in 2021. And so we keep going until it gets done. We know that when we pass a law, that's the beginning, not the end, and that our people need help, our people need services, and that's what we're working to get done. And so there are detractors, you know, the racial overlay of everything in our country. There are detractors. We talked about some of the African American leadership groups that take money, still take money from the industry, and are saying that what we're doing is criminalizing our community. It will lead to black markets. It will lead to further police officer involved profiling and killing of African American brown and black men. And so those are issues that we must grapple with and that we are grappling with that are very painful. And they have to happen parallel. So we're not gonna wait and get racism solved and then deal with the biggest predator and profiler of our people, which is the tobacco industry. We're gonna do both of those things at the same time.
Very good, Carol. We should keep in mind that even if on the 29th of April the FDA comes in and says, you know, you're right, we're gonna remove this product, it'll take 18 months to 3 years to get these products off the market. And in the course of that, you know, the tobacco industry is gonna sue. This fight is not over. This is not nowhere near over. We want to encourage people who are still participating in this at the local level to take this fight up, at the state level to take this fight up. Someone asked a great question in the chat about the Biden administration. The Biden administration has professed to be against health disparities and has been talking the talk of health equity. Well, this is a health equity issue. And we would like to encourage, if there are any of his members of his administration on, to actually take this up and raise this with the FDA and Health and Human Services section.
And Phil, if I can be more provocative, I would say this is a issue of structural racism, to be fair.
To be frank, yes.
Absolutely. Dr. Milner, I'm gonna invoke your status as a historian. While we are fighting this fight against tobacco, we have the growth of the cannabis industry and how the similar forces of identity, of culture, are being used to profit amongst communities of color and other disadvantaged folks. The argument has been that we're decriminalizing marijuana, right? So similar to what Carol just said. What happens next with sort of the commercial marketization of cannabis in conjunction with tobacco? And what have we learned that we need to do now instead of waiting for where we are with menthol and hookah?
Health issues are going to be profound over the next many decades. The concentration of the cannabis outlets in communities of color That's going to be a policy debate over the next many decades. All those things that people have been able to observe about the tobacco industry and its misuse of our communities, those are going to be, we'll see parallel struggles as we move forward. I have no doubt about that, having lived in the Bay Area and having lived in communities of color all my coming of age years, we see what's on the horizon, or we smell it, or I smelled it when it used to come into my classroom.
You know what we often don't do is what people don't realize is let's look at the science behind it before we get away from it. Marijuana or cannabis or whatever you want to call it is what we call a biomass. And just like a cigarette and just like a forest fire and just like burning leaves in the driveway, it produces the same chemicals that you find in a cigarette. It doesn't, you know, there's different active ingredients in different things, but they all produce formaldehyde, acetaldehyde. They all produce these carcinogens. They all produce carbon monoxide. It's marijuana does too. And it's not only true in terms of, when you smoke it, it's combustible. So it's going to similar. It doesn't matter. Those things are going to get done. What it does, and we even talked about this in an earlier conversation this morning, the secondhand smoke laws are coming under threat because now there's medical marijuana and they should be able to smoke it indoors and around other people. It has the same chemicals in it as tobacco. It's just as bad for you. And lastly, I'll say about this, and I think Steve, Dr. Milner, you're right. There was a study done in about 2008 that found out that a portion, and I think it was somewhere in the neighborhood between 7 and 15% of all lung cancer deaths were probably use of marijuana also with cigarettes. And we're gonna have to, in the future going forward, disaggregate that so that we can actually see what the actual impact is. And I could go on forever on it, but I think the questions good, Arnav.
And I know we're against the clock. I do wanna, you know, Carol, as one of the fearless soldiers on the ground, what do we do about this? What do we have to do tomorrow to make sure that we're not having this conversation about marijuana 5-10 years down the line?
Oh, you be.
On the marijuana, on the cannabis question, we're actually, look at Phil smiling, we're actually having some internal dialogues with our council. So we will be having some formal guidance, official guidance from our group. With Dr. Milner there, I supported, the NACP was one of the carriers for the legalization of cannabis in California, mainly because of the criminal justice issues and the incarceration of Black and brown men and the ruining of people's lives behind this substance. So as we see the rollout of legalization in California, it hasn't gone quite as anticipated. It was mainly seen as a way to, for us, it was seen as a way to keep our people from going to jail. For others, it was seen as the gold rush. And so in the mix there are all kinds of equity concerns. There are many different things that need to be unpacked, and we need to have more conversations about it and dialogue, and our community needs to be more involved in the planning and of how this thing is going to continue, going to roll out further, you know, once we get past some of the emergency things that we've had to do around COVID.
Well, I'm a professor who did 5 years in Soledad Prison, working, by the way. I'm not a convicted felon, but having worked in a setting where I was behind 7 steel doors, was unnerving, but that was our people there. So I had to keep going back in because if we don't do it, who will? And if we don't talk about these issues openly and with seriousness, who will? And these things we do see on the horizon because it's easy to predict it. as Dr. Phil just mentioned, anything that involves that, you know, smoking will get your body. So we've got to keep working against it.
So with that, again, I am so honored to be in virtual presence with the three of you, not only as colleagues, as friends, but as brothers and sisters. So let's keep up the good fight. Let's stay in solidarity. And I hope that we have provided some level of inspiration to the audience that we can do this together, and we will do it together. With that, I turn it back to Nicole or Tracy to take us through the end.
Thank you very much. This concludes our program. Thank you to all the scholars and for all the attendees. So the recording will be made available soon. And again, as Nicole said, follow us on savingblacklives.org. Have a great day, everyone.
Amen. And before everybody hangs up, if this were a virtual event, I would have some flowers to present to both Tracy Brown and to Nicole Turkson, who really have pulled off a phenomenal event. I really want to just salute Tracy's leadership, because she was the one who presented this and carried us forward when we were kind of like, what? And it's been excellent. It's been needed. It's been timely. And so I just want to applaud our A team here. And thank you very much publicly. And the flowers are coming.
great video, Nicole. Great opening music in the opening. Some of the first thing in the chat said, that was great. It was a great opening.
Wonderful. Yeah. Thank you
all so very much.
All right. I got it. Bye. Thank you, everyone. Bye. Everybody. Bye. 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 Bye.